You hear it all the time. You need 1,000 foot-pounds of energy for a deer, you need 1,500 foot-pounds of energy for an elk. But for me, when I'm looking at all the aspects that make a hunting bullet or a hunting cartridge good, bullet energy doesn't even land in my top three. Let's talk about it. If projectile energy was all that matters, number one, archery simply wouldn't work because we're producing a measly 80 to 90 foot-pounds of energy with our arrows at launch and even less out at impact range. And 300 Win Mag shot through the thoracic cavity of a deer creating over 3,000 foot-pounds of energy would drop them on the spot. But fairly often we see them take that bullet through the ribs, run off, and then expire within 100 to 150 yards. So why is that? Well, today I'm gonna do my best to actually break that down for you. Number one, we have to talk about what actually kills a game animal, where in the whole hierarchy of traits bullet energy actually falls, and when it can be useful and when it is not useful. We're also gonna be talking about hydrostatic shock and whether or not it even exists, and number two, if you can actually rely on it, which I have a feeling is gonna be kind of a spicy topic. But regardless, let's get started. So number one question, what actually kills deer or whatever game animal you happen to be chasing? The number one way to take down any animal on the face of the earth, as long as it requires oxygen to live, is to create rapid blood loss and hemorrhaging that leads to a rapid drop in blood pressure, eventual loss of consciousness, and then eventual expiration and death of brain cells. The second method can be completed by targeting the nervous system. So if the bullet strikes an animal somewhere in its skeletal structure and interrupts the flow of neurons through their nervous system, you end up with a complete shutdown and short-circuiting of that nervous system. If you hit the spinal cord, hit the spine, the correct bundle of nerves, high shoulder, brachial plexus, a lot of examples in the animal can lead to this outcome, and it is usually just a drop on the spot, 0 yards tracking, and your deer is right there. Now, once you do have that deer on the ground, and if you are someone that gets your own deer out, packages it, and freezes it all by yourself, you might be interested in today's video sponsor. So this is a pack of out-of-air vacuum sealer bags. They were nice enough to send me out some product to test because they didn't want me to just come on here and tell you that a product was good without me personally using it. So they sent me a little sampler pack, including some pre-cut bags like the ones I have here and this 100-foot roll with a built-in cutter that I liked quite a bit. They wanted me to test this product out before bringing it to you, so I wasn't just talking about a product I'd never used and being like, trust me, bro, it's good. Here's what I've learned by using them. They are, number one, pretty reliable on their sealing, and number two, they are more durable than other bags that I've used on the market. If you seal your own meat from the field, if you buy meat in bulk and cut your own steaks, investing in good vacuum sealer bags can be really important to protect that investment. I know personally, if I bring wild game home and then I find it months later freezer burned in my deep freezer, I feel really, really bad about it. I feel guilty about it. I feel like it's disrespectful to the animal itself, and I try to avoid it in any way possible. These are going to avoid that better than a thinner and cheaper bag. So if you're interested in checking out the product for yourself, there's a discount link in the description below, outofair.com/outdoor tactics. Thanks, guys. The number one reason I think bullet energy is flawed is because the calculation to actually determine bullet energy is just the mass of the bullet times the velocity squared. So you can tell that by jacking up the velocity of that bullet, since it is a squared component of that formula, it's going to increase your energy exponentially. The problem with that is a faster bullet is not always better. If the bullet is not constructed correctly and it can't handle that speed, or if you push it at such a fast speed when it impacts bone, it could pancake, it could fragment, it could lose so much mass that it interrupts its own penetration and does not perform all that well on game. Now, there are some bullets that are designed to expand very violently and fragment into multiple wound channels. Those are a bit of an exception to the rule and not something that I have a ton of experience with. I much more prefer a controlled expansion bullet. It still expands very well, but it holds its mass to retain its ability to penetrate deeply through that animal and get to the vitals regardless of the shot angle itself. So essentially what I'm trying to say is that bullet construction and the velocity at which that bullet impacts your target matters much more than the energy it carries once it reaches that target as well. I've got an entire video laying out 5 different types of hunting bullets, ranging from standard cup and cores to bonded to monolithic. If you want to learn more about how bullet construction will affect the way a bullet performs on game, check out that video. I will link it in the description as well as right above in the cards. So let's do a little experiment here. Let's do a side-by-side comparison of a very high energy cartridge loaded with the wrong bullet to a fairly mild energy cartridge loaded with the correct bullet. So to show you that bullet construction matters more than bullet energy, I'm gonna take a 30-06 loaded with a 150 grain FMJ bullet, so just a uniform jacket across the whole thing, no expansion mechanism, no exposed lead. And I'm going to take a 243, let's say a fairly mild interlock loading from Hornady, and we're going to do a quick comparison. So launching a 150 out of a 30-06 at 2,700 feet per second will yield you about 2,450 foot-pounds of energy at the muzzle. Let's just take muzzle energy as our bullet energy for this example. What's going to happen with that bullet is it's going to pencil through a 30 cal hole straight through the animal that you shoot, unless it happens to tumble or fragment because it's being pushed so fast. But a 150 FMJ at 2,700 should have no problem holding together as it passes through a deer, an elk, whatever you might encounter. So 30 cal hole, very lackluster temporary cavity, very lackluster damage done to the vitals, and not even arguably a very unethical bullet to use in the field. It's not going to work very well at all. Now let's talk about a 243. And just to exaggerate this analogy, I'm going to talk about the Hornady Custom Light Load. It is an 87 grain SST coming out of the muzzle at a measly 2,800 feet per second, producing only 1,500 foot-pounds of energy at the muzzle. Here's the difference though. A 243 loaded with an SST bullet is going to expand rather violently on game at a lot of ranges. That bullet is designed to expand and deliver really, really good performance on game all the way down to, I believe, 1,800 or 1,600 feet per second. Let's say it's 1,800 feet per second. And that velocity doesn't even become relevant until about 500 yards. And at that point, still only carrying 611 foot-pounds of energy, but would still be able to take big game no problem, because that bullet is going to do what it is designed to do, provided it doesn't hit too heavy of bone, and it will create a wider temporary cavity, tearing and ripping at those arteries, veins, and lung tissue inside the thoracic cavity of a deer, elk, bear, whatever you might be hunting. Now, I'm not saying you should take a 243 light load out to 500 yards on an animal. That'd be very against a lot of things that I believe in, but the example still holds true. Even out to that 200, 300 yard mark, that bullet's gonna do some pretty serious work. And before the comments say, oh, we go to war with a 55 grain 5.56 FMJ and we do just fine. No, we don't. We have to hit people like three or four times to actually put them down where we want them to go down, because those bullets don't expand, although they can fragment at some fairly short ranges. So we talked about why bullet construction matters more than bullet energy. Let's talk about shot placement, and this is going to be fairly short. Let's say you shoot a deer in the leg with a 300 Win Mag. It might not walk well for a while, and it might die in a few days, but it is going to be just fine for the time being and well able to get away from you. If you fish a 22LR through the ribs and hit the heart, it is going to be dead inside of a minute, no problem whatsoever. So shot placement truly is king, regardless of what other aspect you're talking about as far as hunting ballistics go. If you don't hit them in the right spot, they're going to survive. Deer, elk, bear, they're all really, really tough animals. Let's get into where bullet energy can actually be of some help. Now, bullet energy can be increased by increasing the velocity of your round, which can make it fight wind, basically because it's spending less time in the air to be affected by wind, and drop much, much better. A faster, flatter projectile fired out of, let's say, a 300 Win Mag versus a 308 is going to be beneficial for hunting, because it's going to have less drop and less wind drift out at longer range. Also, by pushing a heavier bullet, which jacks the bullet energy up as well, you're going to have a higher ballistics coefficient if you keep the design of the bullet relatively the same. So let's say, again, a match bullet out of a 308 versus a heavy match bullet out of a 300 Win Mag. Even if they're going the same speed, the higher ballistics coefficient of the 300 Win Mag bullet is going to help it fight drop and drift out at range, and it will also deliver more energy on target, because a higher BC helps it retain more energy as it gets out there at longer range, keeping it within that expansion band and keeping it ethical to use on game for extended distances. So for example, I shoot a lightweight Barnes TTSX out of my 308 religiously. That bullet past 400, 500 yards sucks, because it's a lightweight bullet with a low BC. That low BC really starts to bite you in the butt out at longer range when that bullet is dropping energy and dropping velocity faster and eventually falls out of its effective velocity window, where it will no longer expand below 1,800 feet per second. If you choose a lead core bonded bullet or something heavier in a bigger cartridge and you launch it out there to longer range, because it's got that higher BC, which also coincides with higher bullet mass and bullet energy, it's going to retain that velocity for longer and stay within its expansion window at longer ranges than something lighter with a worse BC and less energy and mass. Regardless of bullet energy, it needs to strike in the velocity band that it was engineered to expand in, and it needs to strike the correct area on that animal, namely the about 8 to 10 inch circle of the vitals right behind and including the shoulder. If you don't place that energy in the correct spot and you don't deliver it to the vital organs, it doesn't matter how much energy you brought to the party, it is not going to get you your deer on the ground. So those are the pros to bullet energy. The biggest con to chasing around bullet energy is you're going to end up with some pretty gigantic cartridges if you take this game too far. By pushing heavier bullets at higher velocities, you're going to end up with bigger, heavier rifles because they're typically going to have to be built on magnum or long actions, and you're going to have a lot more recoil to contend with, which just makes the rifles harder to shoot. There's a lot of really good shooters out there that can shoot high recoiling rifles better than I can shoot low recoiling rifles, but on the average and as a whole, if you take a hunter, lay them down prone, and ask them to shoot a group with a 243 or a 375 shy tack, they're going to shoot a better group with the 243 because it's more mild and easier on the shooter themselves. Okay, let's talk about hydrostatic shock. And the reason that hydrostatic shock is coming up in this video is because I hear a lot of people say, I shoot a high energy cartridge so that I can deliver hydrostatic shock to the vitals on a deer and shut it down immediately, which is that secondary mode of taking down a deer, elk, whatever, that we talked about early on in the video. This is also sort of a flawed metric, but it is something that I can partially get behind. Let's explore this for a second. Okay, first and foremost, hydrostatic shock is not a myth. It is a measurable thing that has been measured scientifically in a study out of North Carolina, and it is essentially when the temporary cavity or the swelling of a wound cavity as a bullet impacts and passes through somehow disrupts the nervous system around it and delivers that hydrostatic shock and nervous system damage to the animal, dropping it on the spot, complete shutdown, and you've got your deer. This study from the South Carolina Department of Natural Resources basically tested this theory on live animals in the field. And the big issue with this theory was that it was very unpredictable and hard to replicate. I'll spare you the exact details, but I will leave that study link below if you feel like reading it for yourself. Essentially, what they found was a soft point bullet traveling at a faster velocity, which, as we know from the energy calculation, higher velocity jacks up the energy pretty darn fast. Those bullets had a higher tendency to create enough hydrostatic shock to drop a deer in its tracks than something like a tougher monolithic bullet that might not expand as fast and might not dump all of its energy so early in its flight path. Now, as I've already covered in my bullet construction video, that standard cup and core soft point has the upside of having very violent and very fast expansion inside the thoracic cavity, but a few downsides, including a general lack of durability when they impact bone or if you push them too fast, whereas those tougher monolithic bullets tend to ignore obstacles very well and penetrate deep enough to reach the vitals from virtually any angle. But bottom line from this study is that hydrostatic shock is real and is something that you might get lucky with, but it is not something to be relied on. Shot placement is still king, shot angle is still king, and bullet construction and the impact velocity is still king over bullet energy. Now, if you have more confidence going into the field with a higher energy bullet, I do not blame you whatsoever. As shown in this study, getting a bullet to drop that high energy very quickly inside the chest cavity of a deer or around anywhere that the central nervous system would be damaged is a very valid way to take down game. So if that's the way you want to do it, absolutely go ahead and do it. But don't use energy as a bit of a crutch. You don't want to fully rely on it. You want to make sure that your bullet construction is appropriate for the animal you're chasing. You want to make sure that bullet is striking at an appropriate velocity inside of its expansion velocity band. And above all, your shot placement has got to be good from the get-go. It doesn't matter what bullet you're shooting, how much energy it has, how fast, flat, sexy, high BC it happens to be. If you don't hit the vitals, you didn't hit the vitals, and that animal is very likely to survive. All right, so I think that just about covers it. If you think I forgot to mention anything about bullet energy, good or bad, please leave it down in the comments so we can get a bit of a conversation going. Probably the best place to do that is right down below. Other than that, guys, I'm gonna go ahead and cut you loose. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye, guys.